be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne.
Considering all the interruptions, you're a jolly professional. So we'd go the whole like that, then again. Yeah, good enough, I think. You'll announce things. Yeah. You're going to pray over me, that's good.
Well, good morning, friends, and welcome to worship on this beautiful Brisbane day. You've received uniting news when you came in this morning. Just highlighting a couple of things. Jesus, the game changer, which started this week just gone, continues for another 3 weeks. Tuesday's leading up to Easter. Not too late to come along when you can. Rose Cafe, closing soon. The numbers are filling up, so you'd better see one of those good ladies to register if you're interested. Christmas child shoeboxes for overseas. As you can see, they're doing the collection of items a little differently this year. Different categories of items each month. The items for March are listed there, so your help's requested where you can. And I believe there's some sort of receptacle in the entry for you to put those in. Okay, thank you.
Let's hear the word of the Lord, those online and those present here today. The law of the Lord is perfect. Wherever you are, it converts the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yes, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than the honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and in keeping them there is great reward. Our response can be, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let's stand, if you are able, as we sing, Morning Has Broken. 19.
Bird. Sweet the rain's new. Sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweet bells of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden so plain. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, pleasing to you. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, my God. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, pleasing to you. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleased. blessing in your eyes, in your eyes. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you. Pleasing to you, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, my God. You're my rock and my redeemer. You're the reason that I sing.
Father, that is our prayer today. How often we struggle as fresh water and bitter water flow from our mouths, from our hearts, from our lives. Please forgive us and help us to allow your Holy Spirit to control our tongues, to glorify you. Thank you for times when we need to speak firmly and for times when we can laugh, for times when we grieve, for times when we rejoice. Help what comes from us to be honoring to you and a blessing to others, seasoned with grace, with salt, with truth, with hope. Through your Son's name we praise you. And the people said, Amen. Wondering if we have any March birthdays to celebrate. I'm sure there's some March birthdays. Elder Gary will go around and catch up with you. Just flick it over. You'll have to finish with Gary.
Yes, on Wednesday last, I made it to 94. And March is a popular month for my family birthdays. We have 17 of our family having birthdays in March. And Wednesday week, my eldest child, son David, turns 70.
Thank you.
My birthday is on the 27th of March, and a lady never tells her age.
Okay. Thank you.
1st, I'll be just 98.
And I'm 60, 5th of March. Thank you.
Hi, I have a birthday on the 24th of March, and I'll go with Anne, and a lady doesn't tell her age.
Just right next to you, mate. Just ask one of the nurses to speak to us.
Matthew and Sarah had a little baby daughter Sunday last week, and we didn't get to sing happy birthday to her at Messy Church, because Job and I didn't know about that. And her name is Vivian Ray, Ray in Star Wars.
Thank you, Gary. 30th of March, I'll be 66.
You're older than what I thought you were, mate. Anyone else?
Yes, well, we have a elder son, Adam, who's honoured to share a birthday with Ron. Last Wednesday, he was 47. And his elder son, Ethan, our grandson, turns 12 later this month.
Okay. Thank you. Well, let's sing to those many people.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. May you find Jesus near every day of the year. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. And the best year you've ever had.
Once more for the road.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Okay.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. May you find Jesus near every day of the year. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. And the best year you've ever had.
And that goes for you also who are viewing and who we didn't quite hear when your birthday is, but we trust that Jesus will be close to you today and on your birthday and every day. We got some children around. Where's our children? Do you want to grab that microphone, darling? And maybe you might like to just say...
Good morning.
Hang on, try again.
Good morning.
Does that work?
Good morning.
That's three times. You got the message. It is a good morning. Thank you. And today I was over at the hall and it was being set up rather... There's a lot of gear out there. You're going to have a great time this morning. One teacher, one student, and I think there was about eight desks out there and a whole lot of activities. And can you see anything unusual in the church building this morning? A communion table, very good. Who hasn't seen the communion table for ages? Hands up. The communion table came back. We had two services, a memorial service and a funeral service this week. And we have a funeral service that off-site, and next Saturday on site there is a memorial service for Rebecca Sparks. And we've brought the communion table back, we've brought the rails back. And perhaps that reminds us that some of us might have been off the rails and that we need to come back and submit ourselves to God. What else did you see, darling? That. What do you think that's all about? It could be taking steps to heaven. It could be. Sorry? There's no opening, so you hit your head once you get there. Yep. Question is, how do you get a grip to get there anyway? True? Because our safety officer has declared that the bottom steps must be covered so that no child, you wouldn't do that, would you, Destiny? Would you like to climb up there? Okay. Anyone else like to climb up there who's over 80? No hands. Well, some people who are well advanced in years like to do really interesting things. And one of the interesting things that we did years ago was we went to Africa, and we're going to show a little clip of that now, I believe. And it was when Rebecca was about 20 months, and we just need a bit of volume, I think. And it's all about the word of the Lord. Does God create well, or does God create well?
Just modeling.
I can't believe they just walk around like.
Lots of things Jesus is acclaimed to do: redeem, heal, deliver, restore, protect, bless.
The Spirit is mine.
military concerts in Zimbabwe.
The story of how the stars were put into place. And the story of the world's ultimate paratrooper. The Lord Jesus Christ. You see, every page and every chapter of this book point to the Lord Jesus Christ. All of history points to the Lord Jesus Christ.
What Jesus Christ has done for us.
Amen. We thank you for sending him to the earth for us. We thank you that he died so that we might live. We thank you that he was broken so that we might know wholeness.
Those Bibles were worth a month's wages for the army people, and the Zimbabwean army had reduced their numbers lots in those days from disease, and it was an opportunity for them to respond to the gospel, and many did respond, as you saw. And it reminds us that God worked in the old days, and God is keen to work today for those whose hearts are open, whether we're children or adults. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for mission trips, and we thank you for visiting our hearts daily and weekly by your word and by your Holy Spirit. Thank you for confronting us with our inadequacies. Thank you for helping us believe in Jesus. Thank you for helping us live as Christ-centered people, whether children or adults. And thank you for helping us rejoice in what you have done today as you speak to us afresh in the hall, in here, and in those who are in their lounge rooms. And may your presence be felt. May your presence change us today. For Jesus' name's sake we pray. Amen. We're going to sing. Thank you.
God loves you and I love you, and that's the way it should be. God loves you and I love you, and that's the way it should be. We should love others like sisters and brothers, and that's the way it should be. We can love others like sisters and brothers, and that's the way it should be. Because God loves you and I love you, and that's the way it should be. God loves you and I love you, and that's the way it should be.
Gary will now come and lead us in our intercessory prayer, with the prayer that Dr. Paul has written based on the lectionary readings for this week. And then we will be singing a song called Thy Word while we're seated, and then we'll hear from the scriptures. Thank you.
Our intercessory prayer will be a responsive prayer. There's parts for you ladies, even parts for you men, and the words will be on the screen. Okay, let's pray. Let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing to you, Lord, our rock and our redeemer. We pray as gospel people whose lives are being transformed because of your cross-shaped love for the world in Jesus. Father, Son, Spirit, you have created this world of wonder and its people in love. Heaven is declaring your good work, the planets, the stars, the mountains and valleys, the oceans and their shores, the wetlands and the deserts, and all the living creatures of this earth speak for themselves. Every corner of the earth shouts your name. Through Adam and Eve, we recognize your image within us. As your stewards, we are all given accredited discretionary powers. We acknowledge the responsibilities of earth keeping, a charter to care for the earth against forces of pollution, global warming, and shrinking biodiversity. We commit with all Australians to clean up Australia today, to support universal access to COVID vaccination, to work for peace and the rights of the oppressed. With you, we hear the cries of the poor, the unborn, and all who live with unresolved suffering. You are our Redeemer from the scourge of sin. Your instruction revives our very being. Your laws make our naivety wise. Your regulations gladden our hearts and give light to our eyes. We confess the reality of sin, our lives, and its impact in the world. We acknowledge the beauty of the law given to Moses. As a schoolmaster, we know it is your will to love you with all our hearts, to turn away from other gods, to not make an idol, to honour God's name, to remember the Sabbath and to keep it holy, to honour our parents, don't kill another person, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't testify falsely against neighbours, don't covet anything belonging to your neighbour. The good news is we are set free from sin and the law through repentance and trust in the cross-shaped love of God in Christ. Our world sees God's self-giving love in the death of Jesus as scandalous. The self-giving love of God in Christ is not weakness. It is the redeeming power for the Jew and Gentile, slave and free, male and female, rich and poor. The cross is God's signature of love to our world. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be the cross-shaped presence in this world. May we live lives of resurrection power as we live out our calling today. And God's people said, Amen.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp. think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Whoa. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart is ever is wandering. So Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end. Whoa. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and a light unto my path, and a light unto my path. You're the light unto my path.
Friends, as we open God's word, we're turning first to the Old Testament, to the book of Isaiah, reading from chapter 55 from verse 6. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to their God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go out in joy and be led back in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall burst into song, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall be to the Lord for a memorial, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. This is the word of the Lord. Turning then to John's Gospel, reading from chapter 2, from verse 13. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at the tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
If I ask you what the word zeal means, can you help me out? What does the word zeal mean? Whoa. Fervent desire to do something. Thank you. What else does zeal mean? Say again. Passionate, unwavering commitment and energy and enthusiasm. How much zeal is in the room today? Tons. How do you measure it? If we were to take some strips of leather maybe we could spell a word W-I-C-K-E-D-N-E-S-S. Anyone want to be a volunteer this morning? I could do with a volunteer. I wonder what the whip looked like that Jesus put together. I wonder if it was like this one. Two volunteers then, please. Well, I guess we'd just like to test it out. But they say this was a premeditated act of Jesus. In other words, it wasn't something that was just spontaneous, but he was troubled when he went into the courts of the temple and saw what was happening. How people were being provided for in ways that made it convenient for sacrifices, but the implication is that the charges were great and that people were being ripped off and that they were using God's place for other than what it was designed to be used for. The temple tax apparently needed to be provided and different kinds of change would be given. But it must have been a dramatic event on the day. And there's a two-part process, apparently, that was identified. Two parts, but we'll do it in one part today. Jesus was unimpressed. Why? Because the people were missing the point. They were being ripped off and God was not being honored. This was the first of the times that John records, the first opportunity for people to be driven out of the temple. The second one is recorded in the other gospels as the cleansing of the temple. But it must have had a much more deeper and stronger meaning than first meets the eye or hits the ear. In fact, if I can find the scripture, it says that, I think it's Psalm 69 and verse 9 says this, "Because zeal for your house has eaten me up." Sounds very strong, doesn't it? Something about zeal. My little summary of zeal was simply this. Zeal is pursuing someone or something with all your being. Jesus is pursuing his Father's honor with all his being. He was thinking about it. His heart was turned toward his Father, but he needed to do something practical to help the people, and that he did. And things changed that day, but we don't know how long they changed for, because it appears within 2 or 3 years it seemed to be back to how it was. People had forgotten that God is most important and forgotten what God's honor and respect and the awe of the Lord was all about. In fact, Malachi 3 brings this out, brings out the messianic psalm, and the second part of that verse is actually quoted in Romans 15:3 as well, because Paul recognized that and encouraged the Romans with it. The second part being the reproach of those And I'll just turn back there for a moment. The reproach The reproaches of those who reproach you have fallen on me. There's something prophetic about this whole event. And Malachi says, "Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant, in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. He will purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer to the Lord an offering in righteousness." The zeal of God. The zeal of God within Jesus couldn't let things stay as they were. Do you ever sense that zeal in your own life? Is it ever there that you think, something's got to be said here, something's got to be done here? We cannot just go on with the routine, with the ritual or whatever. We really need to connect with God. And things need to change. In fact, we need to change, starting with me. Do you ever feel that? Do you ever sense that? That God is wanting to do something. That the Holy Spirit is stirring up a zeal within people to say, enough is enough. I've heard it said before that Jesus wants his church back. What a confronting statement. God wants our nation. God is calling our leaders back to him. The church belongs to Jesus. He said, "I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it." And yet there seems to be a lack of zeal, a lack of comprehension of what's good and evil, of what's right and wrong, of what is true and false. But here Jesus begins after his first miracle at the wedding. One of the commentators at least speaks about this as a second miracle. A miracle where Jesus does something and things change. Take these things away. Do not make my Father's house a house of merchandise. His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house has eaten me up." Can't stand it any longer, got to do something. God's honor is at stake. So the leaders challenged him, and he was not prepared to perform miracles as they requested, but only as God directed. So he says, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up," or it will be raised up, maybe more literal. What a prophetic word. They talked about 46 years, but he was speaking of the temple of his body. This is part of his prophetic mission, was to go to the temple. Why did he drive these animals out? Maybe it was because he was warning the people that soon you won't have to buy sacrifices here. soon you won't have to bring animals and shed their blood for your sins, because something more profound is going to happen. Was he not predicting his own death? Was he not predicting that he would die and come alive again on the third day? Was he not wanting to clean the place out and say things will be different soon? And soon enough, it happened, but it wasn't pretty. And when he had risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this to them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. It wasn't just about zeal, it was about the word. They believed the scriptures, and they believed what Jesus said, which we now have as scripture as well. Thank God for the New Testament as well as the Old Testament. They believed what was written, and they believed what he spoke. We believe what is written and what he spoke because it is written for us also. But perhaps there's another dimension to this, and it's borne out in Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, 19 to 22. Now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. What Jesus began to do is happening in our day. It's continuing in our day. It was as it was in the first century. Him being the chief cornerstone, the whole building being fitted together, growing into a holy temple in the Lord. That's us. Are you excited that you're part of a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a chosen people, and more, as Peter would declare it? Or does that give you no zeal at all? Isaiah God speaks. My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways. As the heavens are higher, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than yours. This really represents for us today, how do we attain, how do we get closer to God's thoughts, to God's ways? Do we need to climb a ladder? Do we need to elevate ourselves closer to heaven? Climbing the ladder is normally where people talk about success. And yet climbing the ladder God's way is actually humbling ourselves. Sorry, I find it hard to stay here. Okay. The point is that we can't climb towards God, but God has come down to us. He came down to us in Jesus. He's come down by the Holy Spirit. In fact, the Holy Spirit is called height power. That power is available to us. It's where we gain the zeal, the conviction, the hope, the excitement, the enthusiasm, and more for what God wants to do in the earth. And we are people who are called to be part of that zealous group. And we may think of zealous people as being the Jehovah's Witnesses or those who go around publicly. But what if God called us to be more zealous than them? What if God called us not to climb the ladder of success, but to recognize that God has come to us, and therefore we must go out to others with good news and say that God's made his thoughts known. God has given to us everything that pertains to life and godliness through his word and through his spirit, so that our ways have been walked by God himself. God has been incarnate in Jesus, and he is the one who recognizes that we become his temple. And he does want to drive out some things that hinder us from being his people. He does want to take out the things that destroy us, that limit the life that he's given. The things that capture us and cause us to be greedy people. That we are taken from being greedy to being generous because of Jesus. And that's an elevated state, but it's a humble state. And the things that the world looks up to misses most of what God is doing in building people up in faith and hope and love. Is there real zeal anywhere? Is it only at the footy? Is it only with human achievement, or is there zeal about God's achievement? Is God doing something fresh in our lives that we can praise him for? One of the churches that I admire has a prayer meeting on a Tuesday night for a couple of hours at least. And they don't get dozens, they don't get hundreds, they get thousands together. And they seek God together. And they call it the engine room of the church, because it's the place where God cleanses the temple of the church, where God changes the people's attitudes, and where people come weeping before him and are transformed, where people get their priorities redirected and they get aligned with God and they stop trying to achieve their own closeness and they humble themselves before God and God lifts them up and God draws the people together and God cleanses and changes. And sometimes he needs to get a whip out, but hopefully not very often. This is a rare occurrence of what Jesus experienced, what he expressed, but it was prophetic of his life. As we prepare ourselves for communion, we're challenged by a little song called The Zeal of God. I wonder, can the Holy Spirit get through to us where we are? Could we become more excited about the things of God than the things of the world? Father, we thank you for the zeal of the doctor. Who ministered to the nurses and brought their little girl out alive in a minute. In an emergency. We thank you for the zeal of those who we consider around us when they recognize that something is right and they make full rejoicing about it. We thank you for the zeal of those who stand against injustice and violence that have no good end. And we thank you for the zeal of those who tell the truth when it is not popular. And we thank you for the zeal of Christ-centered people who ooze with the love of Jesus Christ so that people feel uncomfortable and challenged by the beauty of their character. We thank you for the joy of your saving presence, and we long to be people and a church who are known for our closeness to the living God. Oh Lord, please let your mercy be ours. And we say and we sing Hosanna. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Heaven and earth are
your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, in the highest. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are filled with your glory.
The Holy God came to us through Jesus Christ. And he yielded up his body. It was broken for us. His blood prophetically, the fulfillment of God's cleansing power. Much more important than the cattle and the sheep and the doves that were in the temple, that he drove out, because there was a new way. It was his blood, his body being broken once and for all. It was him who came from heaven, not by a ladder, but by the Holy Spirit. And today he comes to us afresh and says, will you follow? Will you believe? Will you be true to me? Will you live for my honor? Will you bring glory to my Father in heaven? That call continues. And today we're going to experience communion in three places. You're invited to come and to take a capsule and go and sit down, or if you would like to come to the altar, please come to the altar and in your time peel the yellow strip to get your wafer, peel the other strip to receive the juice, and when you're ready, please move back to your seat. Please, we'll have one more song as this is happening, and then we'll have a time of silence. I welcome you to the table of God. Jesus comes to us to share his life with us, to impart his life to us. Let us receive it in his name.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all.
Today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your body, your blood, of which we are partakers. Lord, make today's communion life-changing, that we may hear you speak afresh, that we may be redirected, reconvicted, re-enthused, knowing that you bring forgiveness. Knowing that you bring wholeness. Knowing that you bring hope. Knowing that you manifest your loving presence to us and your correcting call. Thank you for freeing us from what separates us from you. Thank you for leading us into eternal life with your resurrection power in mind, indeed the mind of Christ, more real in us and through us, for the sake of the world in which we live. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. There's no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Therefore, Lord, we surrender to you today, individually and as part of the body of Christ, that we may indeed, humbled by your perfection, may become more like you and more willing to go wherever, whenever, with whomever, for your greater glory. And the people said, Amen. Let the cry of your heart continue to be heard by God.
It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, so I can walk in your truth. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, and make me wholly devoted to you. The cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Open my eyes so I can see the wonderful things that you do. Open my heart up more and more, and make it wholly devoted to you. Whoa, whoa, whoa. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. To be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life.
Let's go from this place with real zeal from the living God.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name.